Project MOST, Canada's first space telescope, and it's quite amusingly referred to as Canada's humble space telescope on account of its size. Today, Dr. Matthew's topic will be probing pulsators and planets with Canada's first space telescope. So without further ado, I'd like to welcome Dr. Jamie Matthews.
Take this opportunity to thank the organizers for inviting me. It's a delight to be part of the GA. It's also a delight to be back in Montreal, which some of you may be aware, I lived here about 10 years ago as an attaché de recherche at the University of Montreal. But I also have a bone to pick with the organizers for scheduling me as the second invited speaker after David Levy. Even after 12 hours, he's a pretty hard act to follow. And so that inspired me to open my talk with a quote from another great astronomer, this time a theoretician, Sir Arthur Eddington. And you can't blame, and he was actually quite a good writer in his own right. If you ever have an opportunity to read some of his books, even from the 20s, they're amazingly accessible. Oh, go ahead, Patrice. And even the technical writings. And you can't blame Sir Arthur for suggesting that there probably isn't any place in the universe less accessible to us than the centers of stars. And it probably would have been hard for him to imagine that we could probe the interior of stars. And today I'm going to talk about a tool, ironically a tool about the size of an appliance, that we hope will allow us to explore the centers of other stars. And as Mark pointed out, I'm going to tell you about how we can probe pulsating stars and in fact explore the atmospheres of distant planets with what will be Canada's first space telescope. Now, any respectable space project needs to have a logo, and here is ours, designed by Canadian space artist Paul Feld in collaboration with the MOST team. And any respectable space project needs a logo that has lots of indecipherable acronyms on it, and we've satisfied that as well. Let me give you a guide to the logo. Of course, our primary any respectable space project needs money, and our principal funder is the Canadian Space Agency, and they're also the main supervising body for the MOST project. UBC is in charge of the instrument itself and all the science operations. The prime contractor for the bus, rather inappropriate name given the size of our satellite, is Dynacon Enterprises, based in Toronto, and we have a number of subcontractors. The University of Toronto Institute for Aerospace Studies and Crestech, and also now Spectral Applied Research. Crestech also contributed a few dollars. And AMSAT, it's a sort of a non-for-profit corporation which has become experts in building microsats, primarily for ham radio operators, the OSCAR satellites some of you are familiar with. Then the province of Ontario actually provided some infrastructure money. And I just wanted to point out, too, that since we're studying oscillating stars, this is how a space artist depicts stellar oscillations. And you got to have some dramatic license when you're putting together a logo. Now, MOST stands for Microvariabilité, Oscillation Stellaire, or Microvariability and Oscillations of Stars, a good Canadian acronym. And we promote it as Canada's first space telescope. And you can find out much of what I'm going to tell you about today and many of the images that you'll see today on our website at UBC. So if you want to go out and explore Montreal in the morning, the underground city, given the weather, you can go ahead and just write down that URL and you're all set. When you think of a space telescope, this is what most people think of. This is Canada's space telescope. and so that's why we've given it that nickname, the Humble Space Telescope. And here it is, almost physically to scale, actually, on the screen. It's about 60 by 60 by 25 centimeters, the entire satellite, and weighs about 50 kilos. So you could literally check it onto an airplane.
And they could lose it for you,
like Canada has done for me on many occasions. I'm not going to go into all the details of the exterior of the satellite.
Suffice it to say that it's a real satellite. It has all the nernies
that make it a real satellite, solar panels and magnetometers and radiators and so on.
And I'd be happy to discuss some of the design details later.
I'm more interested, and I suspect you may be more interested, in the guts of this satellite, which is the
telescope and the CCD photometer, which will return the science data, which is nestled inside the instrument bay.
And we also, of course, have solar panels everywhere we can, but our entire power output is only about 30 watts peak.
So that makes quite a constraint if you're trying to do this kind of precise science on a low mass, low power, low volume,
low
money budget.
And that's the story of MOST, in fact. MOST is a bit of a pioneer technically as well as scientifically, because it will be the first pointed microsat. If you think about it, if you were to put a suitcase into space, say one of the old shuttle getaway specials, and you just tossed it out of the cargo bay, the problem is if you tried to steady it, it will constantly be feeling varying tugs due to the gravity of the Earth, because the Earth is not a perfect sphere. Sometimes you're passing over mountains, sometimes you're passing over ocean basins. The moon has a gravitational effect on it, and even atmospheric drag. Even at altitudes of hundreds of kilometers, there are enough air molecules and atoms up there that these satellites feel drag, and they will begin to tumble relatively quickly because they just don't have enough inertia to maintain a specific orientation. So that's why most of the astronomical satellites have fairly large masses. You need to have a steady platform on which to anchor the mount, in a sense, of your telescope. So no one's ever tried to do science like this with such a small payload. That changed when Dynacon Enterprises developed a new system, an attitude control system, miniature reaction wheels, in a sense, miniature gyroscopes. They're little spinning things in tin cans weighing only about 100 grams each. And you can use these now to stabilize a small platform to a pointing accuracy of about plus or minus 10 arc seconds or better, at least 99% of the time, to be within an error circle of about plus or minus 10 arc seconds. Now, as you know, that's lousy pointing on the ground for ground-based telescopes, and it's lousy pointing for telescopes like the Hubble, but it's actually an improvement of a factor of about 400 over what anyone's ever achieved with a payload this small. The normal pointing accuracy for something this size is plus or minus 1 or 2 degrees, so several times the diameter of the full moon. So suddenly, you're in the regime where you could actually do some astronomical science, or potentially as well terrestrial monitoring. And there's been some speculation that MOST is actually a secret Canadian spy satellite to look down on the Americans. And in fact, we would. Our angular resolution would actually just come under the limits set by the US military that's given RADARSAT-2 so much problem. So don't anybody tell that outside of this room. We're not being launched by the Americans anyway, but we don't want to have any more problems with them. But what that means is that we can now do this kind of optical science on a small platform, low mass, so we can afford to put it into space, and that means that we can do it on our own in Canada, which is unusual because Canadian space astronomy is not exactly the best funded in world terms. We've got NASA, the European Space Agency, the French Space Agency,
and the Canadian Space Agency. I should emphasize this is on a logarithmic scale. So that means that we can do MOST for a price of about $10 million Canadian. Checking this morning, that's about $17.95 US. And we are literally the Zellers of space telescope projects, and very cheap. The space agency hates when I use words like cheap. They also hate the Hubble space telescope tag, so don't tell them I was telling you this either. So let's call it economical. But it really is a big bang for the buck, which I think is why our project has been so well received by the Canadian public so far.
And speaking of big bang, that's where every astronomical justification comes about. We're always talking about origins. And in fact, the MOST project will deal with scientific questions across a wide range of astrophysical aspects. From, in some sense, exploring the early history of the universe by looking at some of the oldest citizens in our galactic city and literally setting a hard lower limit on the age of the universe by independently estimating the ages of those stars, a best before date, as Chris Impey at the University of Arizona Stewart Observatory once said, you can't be older than your mother. So if you can find the oldest things in the galaxy, you know that you've set a lower limit on the age of the universe, a best before date on the universe. We're going to explore stars which are the favorites of Tony Moffat here at the University of Montreal, Wolf-Rayet stars, which are belching gas out into space, in fact providing the raw materials for future generations of stars, and are the last stages, we believe, before they erupt as supernovae. So we get to explore the final pages of the last chapter of the lives of very massive stars. And we'll even get to explore the atmospheres of extrasolar planets and put all of that in context. So essentially bridging the entire spectrum of modern astronomy and some of the hottest topics in astronomy today, all for a price tag of $10 million, which is a lot for you and me, but for a space project and for a major astronomical research project, I think it's a bargain. So how are we gonna do it on this bargain basement budget? There is a miracle involved. There are many miracles involved, but I'm not a magician or a wizard. Well, I have been in the past. This was at an international conference in Belgium last summer, the banquet, posing as the famous seer Nostradamus. Yeah, I don't know if you can actually see. Do I have my my lightsaber? Ah, Luke, you have constructed your own lightsaber. There you go. It's got a nice long nose there. No, I'm not a wizard. I'm going to take advantage, and the MOST team is taking advantage of something that we've already observed in our own sun. This is another last-minute addition to my talk, inspired by David Levy. Last night, he urged everyone, not during his talk, but as soon as possible, to go and check out the SOHO website, the Solar and Heliospheric Observatory website, so you could see what the sun was like in this very day. Well, I couldn't pull out today's solar weather, but here's an example of what you can pull out on the website. Let me just tell you what you're looking at here. This is a freeze frame of the sun, except you can't see the sun itself. It's been occulted in an artificial eclipse by this mask. The small circle at the center is the actual diameter of the photosphere, and allowing us to see the corona and the solar wind around it. There's actually going to be a comet, again very appropriate for David, that's coming in, and even more appropriately, it's going to hit a body in the solar system, in this case the sun. And we're also going to see the stars moving past, or apparently moving past, as we orbit around the sun. So basically an illustration of all of the things that David talked about, if the technology works. Bill Gates, do your stuff. Well, no, don't do your stuff in this case. Work for a change. And we'll wait for a moment as the technology works at lightning speeds. It always seems to go much more slowly when you're in front of it. It's inversely proportional to the number of people watching. Here we go. So that comet doesn't take long, but fortunately, I think once it's loaded, things will go much faster.
The next time, let's find out.
So look for that.
There we go.
Now keep in mind, that small circle at the center is 1.4 million kilometers in diameter. You can see the time going away at the, ticking away at the bottom. So we're covering several hours here, now a few days. Not a tremendous amount of time. So we have incredible tools to explore the environs of the sun. Its exterior. We know the sun and its outsides better than we know any other star, and although certainly not well enough. But I'd like to tell you about how we can explore the inside of the sun, something that we never see directly. All of the light that we see from the sun escapes from a very thin layer of the photosphere, a few hundred kilometers deep, and the rest of that 700,000 kilometers of solar depth is essentially obscured from direct view, the exception of neutrinos escaping from the thermonuclear core. But what we can see at the surface can betray the interior. Here's another shot actually taken by the SOHO satellite, and this is another view of the sun, but it's not the kind that you would expect to see. This isn't a picture of the light from the sun. This is actually a snapshot of the dynamics of the sun. It's a Dopplergram, measuring the Doppler shifts of the light emitted from the photosphere at different points in its surface. This was taken about 6 years ago, but there are more recent ones. as well. And there's false color imposed here. So the dark regions are basically moving towards us about 2,000 meters per second. The bright parts are moving away about 2,000 meters per second. The thing that gives, and the orange is just the false choice of false color, the thing that makes this look like it's illuminated from the right is the fact that the sun is slowly rotating. It gives that dipole pattern with a period of about 25 days. And I'll reassure you that this is my only cute PowerPoint effect in the whole talk. I couldn't resist that one, but there won't be any little cherubs flying in to point out, you know, numbers and things like that. The other thing in this picture makes it look a little bit like an orange, other than the color, is that dappled surface. And the dappled surface is basically showing you a freeze frame of the turbulence of the sun. The fact that the energy which is being transported, first generated in the thermonuclear core, transported by photons and radiation up to a point about 30% of the depth of the sun from the surface. And then the last leg of that energy relay, basically the gas itself begins to rise, warm, hot gas, carrying energy to the surface and releasing it into space, then settling back in to pick up more energy in this kind of solar bucket brigade of convection. And those have characteristic time scales, the order of hours or so. But if you were to analyze this carefully and look at it as a movie, you would find that, in fact, there are also oscillations buried in here, that the sun is continually vibrating, it's continually humming. What's causing the vibrations of the sun, and why do we care? This was the inspiration for what we now call the relatively new field, only a few decades old, helioseismology. We've stolen a page from the notebooks of the geoseismologists who use earthquakes to probe the essentially inaccessible interior of the Earth to the sun. What's happening is that same turbulence in the convection zone of the sun at the surface it just was talking about generates noise. Basically, it creates sound waves which travel through the gas in the sun. It can't go out into the vacuum of space, so it travels into the interior. The speed of sound depends on the local temperature and the composition of the gas. Now, throughout most of the sun, the composition is fairly uniform. It changes in the center, and that's a key point to what I'm going to be talking about. But throughout most of the body of the sun, the composition is fairly uniform, but the temperature changes dramatically. The sun is approximately 16 million Kelvin at its center and cools off to a balmy 6,000, 5,800 Kelvin near the surface. That's a pretty steep temperature gradient. And so sound waves, which are heading towards the interior, encounter gas, which is hotter and hotter, and hence the sound speed goes up, and they end up being bent around, basically refracted, just like a light wave would be refracted in glass, except this time it's in a gradient of temperature and gas. Now, you don't have to experience this effect. All you have to do is go out camping. How many of you have ever been camping before? How many of you have ever been camping in the sun? Okay, well, you don't have to go to the sun. How many of you have ever been camping beside a lake in the mountains and have gotten up just before sunrise? How many people have had that experience? Have you noticed how clearly, how extraordinarily clearly you hear sounds across the lake? Distances of many kilometers, you can hear a loon's cry, or more often than not nowadays, a loony person operating a motorboat at 5 in the morning. But those sounds carry very clearly. And I've got to admit, when I was camping, when I was a teenager and I first experienced these sorts of things, I always thought it was just because I was away from the city, there was no background white noise of other sounds that are sort of just in the background in our subconscious now we don't notice, and that's why I was noticing these sounds so much more clearly. But I discovered over time that in fact there was a physical effect, and ironically was one that relates to the research that I'm doing. So that when you wake up before sunrise by that cool lake surface, where you are, there's no sunlight, but above your head, the sun has cleared the curved horizon of the Earth and has warmed the air above you. And so there's a temperature gradient that actually has a scale of kilometers. And so sound waves, which would normally be traveling straight directions and never get anywhere near your ears, encounter air of higher temperatures and actually get refracted around. And so you encounter more sound waves from a source that's a few kilometers away than you normally would. So it actually does. It is actually louder. It's not just a perception effect. And as soon as the sun clears the horizon where you are, that temperature gradient is essentially destroyed. And so now you don't hear those things quite as clearly. How many people here are boaters, however, own a boat or spend a lot of time in a boat? How would you describe the way sounds travel around your boat or between boats that are docked within one another or near one another? Ever notice, the sounds are a little bit clearer than normal? They have a different pitch to them sometimes. That's because the same effect still survives on a much smaller scale length above the water, even in the daytime, is that the air just at the surface of the water is being cooled, and there's a temperature gradient which exists now over scales of meters to tens of meters, and so over those scales, sometimes you hear sounds abnormally clearly. And so you can even experience that effect on a boat. But let's get back to the sun. One of the things about the geometry of the sun that's different than the lake surface and the distances we've been talking about is that these sound waves can travel far enough that they actually encounter the spherical geometry of the sun. And they get bent around and eventually go back to the surface where they're reflected, and they bounce around and around, and they can cause the sun to resonate. Some of these waves will actually hit the resonance frequency, and they travel in what we call acoustic cavities, where the lower boundary of this cavity is defined by where the sound speed at that particular temperature and composition is equal to the horizontal velocity of the wave. And so different waves of different periods, different frequencies, different pitches literally, and different entrance angles will penetrate to different depths. And so what we can do is literally reconstruct sound speed as a function of depth within the sun. And therefore we can actually figure out the temperature and the structure of the sun as a function of depth, which is something that we couldn't determine in any other direct way. Now, I'm going to take a big risk here, both in terms of taking more time and in terms of the technology breaking down. And what I want you to do is the frequencies of the sun, the periods of the sun are about clustered around 5 minutes. There are literally tens of millions of such modes. And they're well below the pitch of human hearing, even if they could travel through space. But what we've done is we've basically shifted them into the range of human hearing. And so I'm going to wait till Patrice says, gives me the all go. What you're listening to is the humming of the sun. These are most of the low degree modes of the sun if you were to shift them into the range of human hearing. And you can hear the beating and resonating, not particularly musical. It's a little bit better than Celine Dion, but it's... sorry. Everybody's a critic, eh? But literally, you can interpret these frequencies basically tell you the structure of the sun, the dynamics of the interior of the sun, the way it's rotating inside. This has told us where the base of this convection region is. It's told us where the magnetic field of the sun is formed. Information that literally only 10 years ago was really not that clear to us. And I think that's probably enough of that.
Is that on a real time scale?
That is on a real time scale, yeah. All that's been shifted is just the... it's just the frequencies, but keep in mind that the beating is part of what determines that. So since we've shifted the frequencies up, we've also shifted the modulation frequencies of the beats. All right, thank you very much. And so we'll go back to our regularly scheduled programming. I have a hand for my lovely assistant, Patrice. So if we think back to that movie of the Soho solar flares and so on, now we've basically got a comprehensive picture of the sun from its interior all the way out to its outer atmosphere and beyond. And the part that's been filled in, which is represented here in false color, the interior, this is actually showing the dynamics, the rotation velocities of the sun. Notice things get very interesting at the base of that convection zone, that the rotation of the sun changes in a dramatic way. I'm not going to talk about that, although I'd be happy to discuss it with people afterwards, but this was a great surprise and has tremendous implications for the way the sun generates its magnetic field, and for the past history of the Sun, that it has this kind of interior rotational properties. What we'd like to do is do this for other stars. So we've answered with helioseismology many questions about the interior of the Sun, and one of the experts on the on astronomy is Calvin's dad. Calvin's asking, why does the Sun set? Well, it's because hot air rises. The Sun's hot in the middle of the day, so it rises high in the sky. In the evening, then it cools down and sets. So why does it go from east to west? Solar wind. Okay. We've all done this with our students or our kids at one time or another. What about other stars? There's a star, kind of yellowish-orangish, another solar-type star. We presume that they're oscillating in the same way. They have all of the same physical properties. Basically, laws of physics, if you kick a big ball of gas the right way through convection, it's going to vibrate like a gaseous bell. So we'd like to extend this technique to other stars. Now, we can find out in advance what we might see by looking at the Sun as if it were a star. There's no law. The International Astronomical Union hasn't said that we have to resolve the Sun and see it as a disk. We can actually take the light from the Sun and scramble it and look at it as if we were seeing an unresolved star. Now, we lose all of that wave pattern information, but we still preserve the frequencies. What you were listening to before, in a sense, is kind of the signal that you would get if we were observing the Sun as a star in an audio sense. Here is a visual pictorial of what you were listening to. Imagine that we had an orchestra in this room, and all the instruments were playing, and we were recording the volume, the frequencies and the volumes of all of the sounds that were being received. And at any one moment, or on average over time, we basically plotted up the volume versus frequency. This is the equivalent for the light variations of the Sun, the kind of photometry that Richard was talking about. In this case, though, it's not absolute photometry, it's relative photometry. We're just looking at changes relative to a mean as opposed to establishing an exact brightness for the Sun at any one moment. And it is taken, just as in Richard's photometry, at two different wavelength bands, here in the far red and in the blue. And what you're seeing down here is the black part is basically the noise floor, and each one of those peaks represents a particular frequency, and the size of the peak represents the amplitude of the light variation, the equivalent of the volume for this kind of solar orchestra. Point out that the amplitude here is given in parts per million. So the variations you were seeing before in Mars were on the levels of percents to tens of percent. These are down at the levels of tens of thousands of a percent. Now, the first thing that you should notice here is that this isn't just sort of a random jumble. There is a pattern here, kind of a picket fence with splinters in the picket fence. I like to think of this actually as a barcode. If it weren't for the varying heights of the peaks, this would look very much like a barcode on a product in a store. And in a sense, it's the version of a barcode for the Sun. If we can scan this pattern correctly, we can actually figure out what the product is inside. And these are data also taken from the Solar Heliospheric Observatory, very versatile space observatory by Klaus Freire. Here is just a schematic. I'm not going to go into the technical details of this. And notice that while we've expanded this technique to stars, we've added the term P-mode. The P stands for pressure, because for sound waves, it's pressure in the gas, which is restoring the restoring force in the wave. There are also G modes, which are possible in stars, where gravity or buoyancy is actually the restoring force. And notice we've called it astroseismology. Now, it's not astro. That's not a typo. It turns out that people who have way too much time on their hands have decided that this is the proper prefix, given the etymology of the word. So we say astroseismology, not astro. Just take my word for it. There was a letter to the observatory, 3 pages long, 2.5 pages of references. 5 of the references were to Xenophon, 354 BC. That particular year, Xenophon, 354 BC, had more citations than I did. It was kind of depressing. But here's just a schematic of that pattern, and you could break that pattern down in its simplest form to a large spacing, that sort of equal spacing that you notice by eye, and then the splintering in the picket fence, the fine spacing. It turns out that the large spacing is essentially telling you how long it takes a sound wave to traverse the diameter of the star. And that's a function of the global characteristics of the star, its mass and its radius. The small scale spacing is basically due to waves which are traveling almost through the center. And waves that travel almost through the center encounter the thermonuclear core. And in the thermonuclear core, hydrogen is being converted into helium during the lifetime of the star. And there is actually a gradient, not just in temperature now. In fact, the temperature gradient at the center of a star like the Sun is relatively shallow compared to the overall diameter. So the sound speed doesn't change a lot due to temperature. But it does change a lot due to composition. And this is where the composition changes. And so the sound speeds going through this composition gradient actually get sent through at slightly different speeds. They arrive at the surface at different times. And that causes this subtle breaking of what an astrophysicist or physicist would call the degeneracy of these frequencies, basically splintering that equal spacing into slightly unequal spacings. And because stars basically have these nuclear furnaces gradually converting hydrogen into helium, and when they exhaust their central hydrogen supply, that signals the end of the normal stable life of the star, we can actually translate this pattern into the age of the star. And I'll come back to that in a little bit. So normally, to do science like this, if we're going to extend this technique, we're going to look at these incredibly tiny signals, micromagnitude amplitudes, in distant stars. You got to use big telescopes, you think. You got to think big. Well, you're right in a sense. Here's an observatory that would be very familiar to Bob Garrison, who ran the University of Toronto Southern Observatory in Las Campanas, an adjoining peak to this, in Chile for many, many years. So here's a shot, Milky Way, the clouds, and so on. This is a 4-meter class telescope. Canada is now a partner in the Gemini project, Gemini North, on the summit of Mauna Kea in Hawaii, and also its twin, hence Gemini, on Cerro Pachon, very close to that Cerro Tololo. And both of these are twin 8-meter diameter optical telescopes. You're familiar with, say, the Keck, which is a 10-meter diameter, or the Hobby Everly telescope in Texas, which is a kind of a similar equivalent diameter. So you would think that you need to devote telescopes like this to that kind of project. Well, in a sense you do, except there is no telescope on Earth that you could devote to this kind of project. You could construct a network of a half a dozen telescopes, twice the size of Gemini, 15 meters in diameter each, distributed around the world, all looking at one of the brightest stars in the sky, third magnitude star in the sky with solar type oscillations, for a week and a half. And this is the barcode that you would get from those data. Assuming perfect weather, assuming no instrument failures, and assuming that all the telescope allocation, time allocation committees in the world suddenly had a fit of insanity and gave me a week and a half on 6 15-meter telescopes to look at 1/3 magnitude star. This is the same result for the same star for a telescope, a single telescope, 100 times smaller, but put in an appropriate orbit in space and equipped with the right instrument. And that's basically the inspiration for most. That if you were, would be virtually impossible to do this. And why is there such a difference? The noise that we're fighting is the noise in the atmosphere. Scintillation makes stars twinkle, also makes them change in brightness at a level about 100 times larger than the signal that we're looking for. And you can suppress that noise by getting bigger and bigger light buckets and averaging the light that you're collecting from stars as it passes through the atmosphere over many, many of the turbulent cells in the high altitude layers that causes scintillation. But you've got to get to telescope sizes of 15 to 20 meters just to start to approach that level, and you've got to be able to monitor this star almost continuously in order to be able to distinguish the subtle changes in the pitches of those frequencies, that fine splitting. It's like trying to listen to two instruments that are tuned to almost exactly the same note and listen for the modulation. You've got to listen for a while before you can pick it up. And we've got to monitor stars almost continuously in order to be able to recognize those subtle differences. So there's really no way we can do this kind of work practically from the ground. So instead of thinking big,
that you can think small. And how small? Well, here's the MOST telescope in its testing phases without the camera attached. That's just actually a microscope objective. We're using it to inspect some images. Just to give you a sense, here's one of Galileo's original telescopes at approximately the same scale. So we're not talking about a large light bucket here. But it's one that has capabilities that the Hubble Space Telescope doesn't have. And it's designed to do one thing very well: ultra-precise photometry. Not ultra-accurate, not getting absolute magnitudes normalized the way Richard's work. We're just getting relative amplitudes to the mean at any one time, but that's all we need. So for stars down to about fourth magnitude, we're going to be able to see one of these oscillations with an amplitude of 4 parts per million with an extremely high confidence in about a week and a half. And the oscillations don't have to be coherent. It doesn't have to be a nicely tuned orchestra. They can be kind of randomly coming and going, and we will still pick them up. Down to the naked eye limit. On Earth, we would get, we have Brent in the audience has a lower naked eye limit than any of us, but this is close to even his naked eye limit. We can get down to 8 parts per million with pretty high confidence in just about 3 weeks. And we can go to quite fainter stars, relatively speaking, for this work, and still far exceed any kind of ground-based photometric precision and sampling thoroughness. So we can basically outdo any of the international multi-site campaigns that we do, including the ones that I organize currently, at observatory stretched in longitude around the globe. And so we can achieve a duty cycle. That doesn't mean that we're doing our laundry during the mission. It just means that we're collecting data more than 80% of the time. Whereas normally, for an observing run, you're lucky to be collecting data at least 50% of the time, and usually much less. So here's an X-ray, in a sense, of the MOST satellite. The light enters through a periscope mirror because we just couldn't fit the telescope in the short axis. We had to fit within the restrictions of a secondary payload envelope because we expected to be a hitchhiker with another satellite. So we've stuck the telescope in sideways. It has a camera which it feeds and is controlled and is cooled by a radiator that passively bleeds its heat out into space. And it's controlled by electronics, which are housed within the rest of the innards of the satellite, the reaction wheels and the onboard computers and so on up there in the instrument, above the instrument bay. Telescope itself is a Maksutov, 15 centimeters in aperture. I think there's probably nobody in this room that has a telescope, you know, everybody in this room probably has a telescope bigger than MOST somewhere at home. It has a wide field of view, and it's fed by that periscope mirror. Here's the overall design, which is basically done by John Pasner, who's now at the HIA, Herzberg Institute of Astrophysics, in Victoria, and built by somebody who's familiar to many of you in the room, Peter Saravolo, Saravolo Optical Systems. David showed a snippet of Peter's video of comet impact last night. And I won't go into the details of the optical design. Most of you are familiar with this, but for those of you that aren't, the light comes in here and it comes up there. That's pretty much it. And here's looking down the business end. It's a beautiful little telescope, and it's lots of things are gold plated for thermal reasons, not just to make it look pretty, but just to give you a few sides. Again, this is the telescope itself. It looks a little bit like a cannon. And it's not a space weapon. It's not Canada's version of Star Wars. We have no moving parts in our telescope for reliability and for low cost, so we don't have a filter wheel. So we look in only one broadband wavelength range, which has been selected to sort of maximize the amount of light we're expecting from our target stars, and I'm showing here the spectrum of a sun-like star, and also the sensitivity of our CCD detector. And we'd like, because we do have a pretty small telescope, we'd like to get as much light as we can. But we have cut it off at shorter wavelengths than the CCD quantum efficiency, just because there are effects in our thin CCD of fringing that could affect our photometry. We're being ultra paranoid, and it probably wouldn't, but why take any chances? And again, I won't go into the technical details, but if anybody wants to talk about fringing and CCDs, I'd be happy to bore you during the coffee break. I may be boring you during the coffee break in this room if I don't speed up my pace here. The filter, by the way, was built by Custom Scientific in Phoenix, the same people who built the filters for the wide-field planetary camera on HST. So we do have a little bit of kind of HST heritage in our Humble project. I said that there were no moving parts, so there's no focusing mechanism. So how do we adjust the focus of our telescope? Well, we don't. It adjusts its own focus. We've built, designed, and built this structure to be athermal, so that we can align it and focus it in the lab at room temperature, and then all of the parts adjust. They have different coefficients of thermal expansion, so that everything sort of expands and contracts in concert, so that across a range from minus 20 to plus 40 Celsius, it maintains the same optical alignment. And we've actually tested this successfully in the thermal vacuum chambers. And this design is primarily due to our subcontractor, Crestec, the Center for Research in Earth and Space Technology, and then their instrument services lab cleaved off into a separate company called Spectral Applied Research, both based in the outskirts of Toronto. Here's again the optical design, and I've just labeled some of the many components. Invar is a version of stainless steel, extremely expensive version of stainless steel. And note that Makor ceramic built by Corning. We're going to talk about Makor again. I may offend delicate sensibilities by the words that I use when I talk about Makor later on in this talk.
Makor break?
Possibly. The heart of the instrument is the CCD photometer, which actually serves two functions. Our instrument just isn't a science instrument, it's also the star tracker, because we didn't have enough room or power or volume or mass to build a separate star tracker as you would on a normal satellite. Small telescope strapped on the side to do that job. So we've built ours to do double duty. So we have two CCDs, identical, but they can be read out entirely independently. One to look at a guiding field, one to collect science data. They're passively cooled, as I said. They basically bleed their heat off into space if they operate at a temperature of minus 40, maintained to an accuracy of plus or minus a tenth of a Celsius. But we know the temperature at any one time to an accuracy of plus or minus a hundredth of a Celsius, so we can even correct for very subtle temperature changes. We have no moving parts, so we have no shutter. How do you end exposure? Well, we took what are called frame transfer CCDs. Let me show you here. Here's the camera in the test bed with the telescope above it. There's maybe another orientation, just to orient you there. There's the camera, the control electronics. Take a closer look at those. These are very low power. They only consume a few watts, and they basically take up the volume of a cigarette case, which is necessary for this kind of project. Here is the focal plane of the MOST instrument, and at the bottom is sort of the photon's eye view as it approaches those twin CCDs, the ACS stands for Attitude Control System. And you'll notice this little compound eye of lenslets that's sitting over one of them. I'll talk about that more in a moment. But let me talk about these frame transfer buffers. That's what allows us to basically end exposures very accurately. Because what we can do is we can transfer the charge accumulated in the CCD extremely rapidly into this buffer and then read it out more slowly at good signal and noise. And so this acts as a virtual shutter. In fact, it's more reliable and even better in terms of time control than any mechanical shutter that we could build, certainly anything that we could build on the MOST budget. And so once again, we've avoided a potential mechanical failure and certainly a huge increase in cost. But the heart of the instrument is basically these micro lenses, this compound lens that I showed you before. Here's a blow-up of what the science CCD would look like. We have this array of 6x6 lenses etched into borosilicate glass. Each lenslet is about a millimeter in diameter, and it's really an impressive little piece of micro-optics to look at. There's only one company, and we know this now, on the planet that's capable of producing these, and it took them 3 tries. To get ones that worked properly, and that was a part of our delay. We basically were working on these for 6 months to get a set that worked and almost abandoned this approach to go back to our mechanical prototype backup option. But they came through in the end, bunch of Russians working for in their own company in Germany. So you've got to have a lot of chutzpah to go into Germany and start up an optics company. But they did it well, and they did this on a budget. In fact, when their first product didn't turn out right, and we convinced them that there was a problem with it, they continued to try it at their expense. So it helps to have a mission scientist who can drink vodka shots with the best of them, because that was part of the negotiating procedure. Basically, the president of the company, the optical designer, and me sat down in a conference room with a 40-ounce bottle of vodka, 40-ounce bottle of Canadian Club, a 40-ounce bottle of Russian cognac. And several hours later, the participants were full and the bottles were empty, but we had our contract. We had a budget we could afford. Now, why are we using these little lenslets? Why don't we just take a picture of the star and measure it on a CCD the way most people would? The problem is that our telescope doesn't point that accurately. It wobbles, plus or minus 10 arc seconds or so. And so the image, even if we defocus it, will move around on the CCD. And as most of you know, the sensitivity of CCDs varies from pixel to pixel. And you can have a bad column, you know, hot pixels or dead columns, and there will be damage that happens in space due to radiation hits. So what we've done instead is put in a Fabry lens, just like you would have in a photoelectric photometer on Earth. It's not usually normally used with a CCD. But what the Fabry lens does is takes the light from the star and projects not an image of the star, but an image of the pupil of the telescope. For the sake of argument, you can just think of it as an image of the mirror of the telescope, although it's not. So you're projecting basically this fixed image, because the mirror is not moving with respect to the rest of the telescope in the CCD. Or if it is, then the satellite is blown up, and that's not good. So it doesn't move on the detector. So as the telescope wobbles and the star beam moves around, this Fabry image stays fixed and gives us much better precision. And this is where we can get down to these micromagnitude levels. So this is what a defocused star image, the kind of thing we use to guide on, would look like. And we'll do secondary science on these kinds of images as well. And the arrows kind of represent the travel, the wander here. These are 20 pixels by 20 pixels. And this is what a target star image, basically an image of the mirror illuminated by the target starlight, even with a defect, you can see a little dimple in the CCD sensitivity, spread out over about 1,000 pixels in this particularly dimmed image. So basically, we're taking pictures of fixed donuts. It's a very Canadian, appropriately Canadian thing. We're hoping to get sponsorship from Tim Hortons, but that never quite came through. Now, so we have an instrument which we believe can produce the photometric precision. Now we have to put it in the right place to get the time coverage that we need. And that means that we'd like to get it as far away from the Earth as possible, but we also have to afford to get there. There aren't too many free rides and cheap rides into geosynchronous orbit. So instead, we're going into a polar orbit about 950 kilometers altitude. And it's sun synchronous, which means that the orbit plane is always oriented in the same way with respect to the sun. Richard did a very good demonstration of the sort of the angle between, say, the observer on Mars and the Earth and Mars and the sun. Well, we can have the same sort of thing between MOST and the Earth and the satellite. And we keep that same orientation so that basically the sun is always behind us. And from this polar orbit with this altitude, there is a cone projecting out from the telescope into space, which just grazes the upper atmosphere of the Earth. And anything within that cone will never be obscured by the Earth during the orbit for weeks at a time. And if it passes right through the center of that continuous viewing zone, then we can monitor that star for a maximum of about 2 months for declinations roughly centered on the equator. So here's like a depiction of the orbit, roughly to scale. And from this vantage point, we're always looking out over the dark limb of the Earth, so we have less scattered light concerns. And our big real estate, 60 by 60 centimeters, of solar panels is always pointing towards the sun, getting its maximum power. Nice thermal characteristics. We don't have the problems that the Hubble had when it was going from across the terminator from daylight to the dark side and experiencing those thermal snaps and so on. Lots of beautiful things about this kind of orbit from a science standpoint, from a technical standpoint. Now, we'd like to be up higher, but if we go too high, we encounter too much radiation in the Van Allen belts and the radiation belts of the Earth, and we will, even in our launch, we'll still be relatively close to solar max, and so we're being conservative. At this altitude, there's very little radiation. Most of these blank squares, these are the fluxes of high-energy protons, greater than 1 MeV for those of you that care about such things. And the colored dots indicate where the fluxes become measurable. That's a region just over the South Atlantic, which astronomers have cleverly called, and the physicists, the South Atlantic Anomaly. I'm sure South African Airlines is happy about that. But it's basically a little glitch in the Earth's magnetosphere in which these charged particles get down closer to the surface than anywhere else. And most will pass through this every once in a while. And we're being conservative. We don't think it will affect our observations, but in case it does, we're not counting on collecting data during those brief passages, and that's part of the reason why we're not counting on getting closer to 100%, but we probably will do better than 80%. From that orbit, we'll be in communication with the satellite from three ground stations, one at UBC in Vancouver, one in Toronto at the University of Toronto Institute for Aerospace Studies, and one in Austria in Vienna at the Institute for Astronomy. And so we'll be in communication with the satellite maybe for a total of an hour or so a day, but that's plenty of time to download the data and to upload any relevant commands. I won't go into the details of the operations, mission operations flow, but I'm like the grand commander. I get to make all the fun decisions in the science master plan. And all of the data will eventually accumulate at UBC and be processed by the science team, and I'll talk about that a little bit. So what are the data going to be? Well, what are we looking at? Well, we know that the sun oscillates, so we're looking at other stars that have convection zones like the sun that would create these kinds of oscillations. In our broad definition, Procyon, or Procyon, depending on your preference, we are considering a sun-like star, even though it's a bit higher than the sun and more evolved, but it's been extensively studied and observed from the Earth, so it's a very good target. It's our brightest target by far. Our exposure times on this star will be about a half a second. Anything longer than that will saturate our CCD, even with a 15-centimeter telescope, even though we're spreading the light over 1,500 pixels. We still saturate in much longer than a half a second on this star. So in some senses, we could have done this, if we just wanted to look at Procyon, we could have done it with a much smaller telescope, but we would like to look at other stars as well. We're also going to be looking at what are called metal poor subdwarfs. And these are what we believe to be the oldest stars in our neck of the woods in the galaxy. And here's one of our prime targets. We'd like to look, and that's where we're going to establish ages of stars. Now, when I talk about ages of stars in this whole process, I like to think of them like automobiles. And here's an example of something off of the astronomical car lot, Spica, B2 dwarf, 17 times the mass of the sun, about 20,000 times the sun's luminosity, and has an estimated total lifetime of about 10,000 or 10 million years. So this is, stars like Spica, these massive luminous stars, I like to consider the sports cars of the universe. They're flashy, you know, they're easy to spot, but they're not very fuel efficient. At the other extreme, there's stars like Wolf 359, familiar to Star Trek fans everywhere, only a tenth of the mass of the sun, 1/10,000th of its luminosity, but an estimated main sequence lifetime of approximately a trillion years. So, you know, these are the Honda Civics of the universe. They're dull, but whoa, do they go a long way on a single tank of hydrogen. Now, the sun is somewhere in the middle. It's, you know, I don't know, a K-car or something like that. And eventually, after a total of 10, 14 billion years or so, it will exhaust its central hydrogen supply. Now, you can look at this a little more rigorously, but even in a fairly hand-waving fashion, and these are the only equations that I'm going to show in my talk, just to explain why we have this range from Honda Civics to Saabs in the universe amongst our stars. All of these stars are generating energy by converting hydrogen into helium. And when they do that, when they take four protons and convert them into a single helium nucleus, turns out that a single helium nucleus actually has a little bit less mass than the four protons that went into it.
and that mass has to go somewhere. It's converted into energy, and Einstein's famous E equals mc squared tells you how much energy E you get from annihilating a mass m, c being the speed of light, big number, square it, even bigger number, get a lot of energy for a little bit of mass. Just to represent that, just in case you're ever worried that the Canadian dollar doesn't have a lot of value, here's I got a loonie in my pocket, unusually enough. I'm estimating the mass of a loonie. Please don't challenge me on this because I did it last night. I didn't have a balanced scale on me, but let's say a loonie has a mass of about 5 grams. I'm trying to think about how much, whether 200 loonies would be about a kilo or not. But basically, if you annihilated the mass of a loonie, you would produce about 5 times 10 to 14 joules. Just to put that in maybe a more meaningful thing, that's equivalent to a 5-megaton bomb. Not quite as much as Comet Shoemaker-Levy produced when hitting Jupiter, but still pretty respectable for a loonie. So this is a very efficient energy generation mechanism. Now, it turns out that when you look at lots of stars in our solar neighborhood whose masses are known from because they're in binary systems, whose luminosities or brightnesses are known in an absolute sense because we know how far away they are from parallaxes, and so on, we find that among stars that are in their adult life in fusing hydrogen to helium on the main sequence, that their luminosities are very sensitive to their masses. Now, the proportionality, the exponent, isn't maybe exactly 3.5. It depends exactly where you are, but it's of that order, 3.3 to 3.5 or so. So basically, if the mass goes up a little bit, the luminosity goes up a lot. That's why those stars like Spica, their masses are only up a little bit, but their energy outputs go up tremendously. Well, the luminosity of the star is basically just how much energy it's putting out per time. And when it's on the main sequence, it's in a fairly stable sense. And so its energy output is changing very slowly. So basically, you could just say, what's the total energy reservoir it has available to it? Divide that by its total lifetime. And that's a pretty good approximation of its luminosity, its energy output at any one time. We also know that the total amount of hydrogen it has available in the core to fuse is going to be roughly proportional to the total amount of hydrogen the whole star has, which is going to be depending on its mass. And so we can actually work out a simple back-of-the-envelope rule of thumb estimate for the total lifetime of a star based on its mass. Very crude. And basically, if you have a star which is less than, say, 0.8, 0.7 solar masses, then that star will have a lifetime longer than something like 16 gigayears, which nowadays is maybe one of the upper limits to the cosmological estimates for the age of the universe. So basically, we want to look at stars which are in this mass range that could possibly have been around that long so we can check. And if we find a star and, you know, we determine its age through seismology to be 14 billion years, then we're going to say we think the universe is at least 14 billion years old. Now, the best places to look for such old stars are in the halo of the galaxy, globular clusters. Globular clusters are, you know, basically, we're talking about kiloparsec distances, those, we're just not going to be able to measure those stars. They're just way too faint for seismology by any instrument that's conceivable in the immediate future. Fortunately, however, we live in the suburbs of our galaxy, if it's sort of the Mississauga of Toronto, the Surrey of Vancouver, but they have expressways that go through the suburbs that take people from the city core into the outskirts, and we also have orbital expressways that take some of the field stars in the halo through our suburban neighborhood, our sleepy part of the galaxy. And so there are some of these halo stars which are actually passing through in our vicinity, which are close enough for us to observe, and in fact are used to calibrate studies of the globular clusters because they represent the same population of stars. And that's what we've targeted. So, you know, if Muhammad can't go to the mountain, you bring the mountain to Muhammad and pick your targets judiciously. Now, are we going to make this all work? Well, we've spent a lot of time basically studying our design and trying to simulate what our instrument would do with very conservative assumptions about noise and performance and so on. And this is a snapshot of sort of some of the simulated science data that we would expect. So what you're seeing over here is the entire science CCD, The shaded area is where the microlens array is, and the yellow box is indicating the part of the CCD that we're actually recording and reading out. We're not going to take all of it at any one time. And then a blow-up of that region, showing our little donut illuminating the starlit illuminated pupil image, and those little dots in the other part are actually stars that just happen to fall into another part of the science CCD field. And we're going to get those data for free. We're going to get very good photometry of any stars that happen to be near our prime targets. And then these are just blow images of the Fabry image, the pupil image, the direct defocused image of those secondary stars, and then all of the other things we need to properly reduce the CCD data, bias, dark overscan,
sky backgrounds, and so on. Well, we produce simulations.
This is what we believe a typical star, bright star, that we might observe over 10 days would look like. Most of them, there's a blow up here over basically a few hours. Now, most of the variations you see there are due to the star, but they're not oscillations. They're due to the convective turbulence, the granulation noise, the star, at a level of about 1%. That's 10,000 times bigger, roughly, than the signal we're looking for.
And yet, if we decompose that into a function of its amplitude versus frequency, we should be able to extract the signal over time.
And I'm going to show you kind of a crude movie
for as the data comes in from this star, day after day,
this is what we hope we will see. The grass is being mowed down as we collect more data, and the signal embedded in the star, very similar to the solar oscillation signal, is rising up through the noise, and there's a little statistical significance barrier there. Most of you would probably have started to believe it long before that little dashed line told you you should, but we're being conservative. After 10 days, we're pretty sure we'd recognize that. After 20 days, it's a lock. Now, you might wonder, how do we pick out this tiny little signal
with all of that other stuff going on?
Well, the beauty of it is all that other stuff is going on at much longer periods than what we're looking for. So there's all of that noise that you saw before, all those other variations. And we're being conservative here. These are raw data, raw simulated data. We've done nothing to calibrate them. All we've done is actually subtracted the bias of the CCD. So we can remove the orbital frequency and harmonics, which we'll know very accurately. We can calibrate any modest temperature variations, all sorts of things to bring this noise level down even further. And this stuff down here, which we consider a nuisance, at least for this kind of science, is actually science for other astronomers, because it's telling us about the power and the physics of the turbulence in the outer atmosphere, and we plan to study that as well. There'll be graduate students and colleagues who are focusing just on that. Now, we have other science targets. Mark, how am I doing for time?
If you could wrap it up in 5 to 10 minutes.
Okay, I think I can do that. I mentioned Tony Moffat. Tony studies Wolf-Rayet stars. Here's an image of the nebulosity around such a star.
We're going to study rapid variability in those stars, studying the process of the turbulence that makes these winds belching out into space clumpy. Basically, these are massive stars near the end of their lives, and they're spewing gas out into space. And they're a principal contributor to the interstellar medium.
And so by studying the process by which this material is injected into the medium, we'll understand the medium itself that much better.
And that's important to understand the next stage, going from the end of a star's life to its beginning, formation of stars within interstellar nebulae, giant molecular clouds. Here's one that's a familiar image to everybody. And
basically the recipe of the universe, 3/4 hydrogen, 1/4 helium, and 1 or 2% everything else.
Somewhere within that 1 or 2%, there's actually a lot of organic molecules.
It's kind of in those of us who are interested in the prospects of life elsewhere.
Bob Garrison has taught for many years a great course at U of T on life in other worlds, and
talking about the physics and the biochemistry of life elsewhere in the universe.
Well, at least we're fortunate to know that the organic molecules, the raw building blocks, exist in other places. Water, glycines, amino acids. My particular favorite organic molecule,
I can tell that some of you recognize this one already, that's ethyl alcohol. I was doing some personal studies about organic chemistry last night, and at the same time studying oscillating heavenly bodies. The place, ironically, called the Club Vatican, 22nd birthday, by the way, so I was sort of putting it all together.
I was an altar boy once, and I think I'm on the road to perdition now.
It turns out that you can estimate
the amount just from the strengths of the emission lines in something like the Sagittarius B2 star-forming cloud. There's estimated to be this quantity of 200 proof, 100% alcohol in the Sagittarius B2. And there's a story, and I don't know if it's apocryphal or not, but I hope it's true, that when this was first reported in the media, NASA radio astronomers had their press release on this, that a Texas distilling billionaire phoned NASA and wanted to buy the distilling rights to the Sagittarius B2 cloud. Now, if NASA had been smart, and we know they're not always smart, but had they been smart, they would have actually sold the rights for whatever they could have gotten. Because although there's a tremendous amount of alcohol in this cloud, it's very thinly dispersed. So if you had a spacecraft with an enormous funnel traveling at 10% of the speed of light, it would still take you a millennium to get enough alcohol molecules to make one single decent dry martini. So the stuff's out there, it's just very thinly dispersed, but it's nice to know that the chemistry, and possibly the biochemistry, is the same elsewhere in our galaxy. And so these clouds are eventually going to form planets. And people have been fascinated by the idea of the formation of planets, the origins of our solar system, for a long time. Here we go, more than four centuries ago. This is from the Sistine Chapel, Michelangelo, the depiction of the creation of the sun and the moon. Now, I'm not an art historian, but I'm assuming that this is the moon. Here's a somewhat more modern depiction of planetary formation, a computer simulation of the condensation of a Jovian mass planet from this typical nebular hypothesis. And I'm not going to talk too much about that. Many of you are familiar with this idea of formation from a protoplanetary disk. This, by the way, is sort of a form of art in itself as well. And that leads me to one of our next exciting science targets for most, and those are the close-in giant extrasolar planets that have been discovered last few years, using a Doppler technique, which was essentially pioneered in Canada by Gordon Walker at the University of British Columbia, Bruce Campbell at that time at the University of Victoria, and now groups like Michel Mayor and collaborators at Geneva and Chile, and also Jeff Marcy, Paul Butler, group at McDonald, and still the group at UBC are all involved in those sorts of searches. Here's an artist's conception of one of the systems. Should point out, of course, that this isn't the planet. This is just an asteroid that the artist decided to stick in the picture. This is the planet. The star is overfilling the field of view. And this particular planet is estimated to have a maximum mass similar to Saturn's. And so artists always have to stick rings around anything that has a mass opposed to Saturn, although rings are unlikely to be dynamically stable in such a system. And the first of these, let me just, I'm here, professional astronomers are always getting a hard ride from amateurs about not actually knowing the skies very well. You know, we concentrate through our telescopes, we never know like what constellation HD 935929873198 is in. So I just thought I'd check, does anybody recognize this field of the sky?
Pegasus, very good. For those of you that didn't, here's just a little thing to guide your eye.
There we go. Yes, that's Pegasus, and 51 Pegasi was the first solar type star to have a planetary companion, to be known to have a planetary companion. Here's an artist's conception, computer generated. We know very little about this planet itself, other than its maximum mass and its distance from its parent star. We know a little more about the parent star, but this would be roughly kind of the perspective from close to this planet, looking at the star. As most of you know, most of the planets that have been discovered through this technique in the last 7 years or so have defied expectation. We have planets whose masses rival or exceed Jupiter's, but actually have orbits which would be well within Mercury's or Venus, Venusian orbits in our solar system. And let me point out that Jupiter in our own solar system is 5 AU away, so basically 5 times this distance, way off the screen, probably out by that door that's going to be locked by 1 o'clock, so we can't get back in. So
This was a bit of a surprise.
And as we've accumulated more of these systems, it's starting to have implications for planetary formation, theories of planetary formation, and looking for habitable planets in the solar system. And this is just a very crude diagram, breaking up, scaling everything to our own solar system and the so-called habitable zone, basically where liquid water could exist on a planet. These are most likely gas giants, but they might have solid moons like Jupiter around them, which are of terrestrial size. So that's we'd like to know more about these things, but it's hard to study planets from a distance. Even our own planets from just outside the edge of the solar system don't betray a lot of information to us. So how are we going to study planets around other stars? Well, one way is if we're lucky enough that one actually passes between the star and us. Here's an example of such a planetary transit, but within our own solar system. That's Mercury just grazing the limb of the sun. This was taken by the TRACE satellite. Here's an artist's conception of the first extrasolar planet known to transit its star. And there is one such system known, and we can, and in fact, HST has been used to try to learn something about the atmosphere of that planet as it passes in front of the star. Part of my science team, Dimitar Sasilov at Harvard, Sarah Seeger now at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, had developed models of the atmospheres of these stars that we can use as a basis to interpret observations when we ever get the data. They've used them to interpret the transits, but most of the time you're not going to have a planet that passes between the sun and you. What happens if you don't have a transit? Well, here's the kind of geometry. We can take advantage of the same thing that Galileo saw when he first looked at Venus through a telescope. Venus shows phases as it orbits around the sun. It doesn't always transit the sun. And these planets will show phases. And we can't resolve them. But it turns out that most will be sensitive to the changes in the brightness of the star plus planet as the planet orbits around the sun and goes from full or near full, gibbous, to a crescent, and back again. Now, in case you don't believe me, here are the models that we've generated, and another student of mine, Dan Green, and I will be presenting these results in Washington, D.C. Next month. We can actually interpret the light curve measured by MOST to tell us about the composition of the atmosphere and the size of the planet, all with a 15-centimeter telescope. Here's our simulated data observing such a typical planetary system over a month. Here we've binned the data now into one-hour segments because we're not looking at rapid variations anymore, and already you can see the signal. And this is one of these amplitude spectra like I've been showing you before, except that there's not a high-frequency peak anymore. Now there's a low-frequency peak with a period of 3.35 days, which is exactly what we put into the simulation. So, in fact, we will be able to detect the reflected light from planets. MOST is the only instrument on the drawing boards for the near future on the ground or in space that would be able to do this kind of work. So maybe we can take a step into trying to establish whether we actually do live in what I like to think of as the Star Trek universe, with many planets, teeming with complex life forms, teeming with biodiversity. This isn't actually biodiversity, this is a bunch of actors with different foreheads. But the idea is there. And maybe we can establish whether the fact that we're not visited often by aliens is because we're the bad end of the galaxy, or whether it's just that there's just not many planets out there that are habitable. So now I will wrap up, because I know I'm going over time and I'm beating into coffee break, so please forgive me. MOST, let me put us in perspective, we're not the only people trying to do this, which is a good sign, because if we were, maybe we were on the wrong track. We have some friendly competition. The French and European collaborators have a project called Corot. Corot is a French Impressionist, was a French Impressionist artist, also stands for convection, rotation, and planetary transits. And it's aiming for a launch in late 2004. Corot, by the way, was started years before MOST was even a glimmer in anybody's eye. And there's a Danish project called MONS, which is having some budgetary difficulties now, but so they were probably hard-pressed to make a late 2004 launch. There's an instrument already up there that's tried to do seismology, the WIRE, Wide Field Infrared Explorer satellite, which was a failed satellite. It lost its hydrogen coolant shortly after launch and was just a big, expensive piece of metal in space that worked perfectly except for the instrument. And and Derek Buzashi at Berkeley at the time realized that it had the Star Tracker telescope strapped to it. So you had this very stable platform with a 5-centimeter telescope, makes most seem big, and thought,
well, let's use it to try to look for variations in stars. And he did. And they've studied a lot of interesting things. But it was never designed to do the kinds of things that these other missions were. And so it hasn't really achieved the kind of seismic sensitivity that most would have.
And then there are very ambitious, very expensive missions. The European Eddington, the American Kepler. Kepler was just recently approved as a Discovery class mission. But they're much further down the road. So we're actually in the lead. And the instrument has essentially completed all of its optical and electronic testing and passed with flying colors. It took us a long time to get the Fabry optics to work. We've tested the electronics at the Triumph Accelerator Lab, exposed them to equivalent of 12 years of radiation exposure in space, and everything still operates well. The radiator system works perfectly. The athermal structure works perfectly. The satellite is being assembled as a flat sat. We don't like to call it a bus because it's kind of small, so we call it a Vespa amongst ourselves. The attitude control system, we've had one of these reaction wheels running continuously since September of 2000. We have a backup reaction wheel on board. There are 4 wheels, and we only need 3. That's one of the little canisters right there, 100-gram canisters. So we're on track with that.
Vibration testing began
basically this month. And just showing a thermal model and so on.
And this is where, just so that I'm not sugarcoating everything and to tell you some of the problems with it, turns out that we started vibration testing at DFL, that's David Florida Labs, outside of Ottawa. And this
was a picture taken of the instrument after vibration testing. And just wondering if there are any aerospace experts who can spot what's wrong with this picture.
Well, here, I'll guide your eye.
Turns out that thing that looks like frost around that tube
there is a cold finger. That's what basically transports heat away from the instrument out into space.
We've taken the radiator away, which is sitting off on the side. And that was a washer made of Maycor ceramic.
And it turns out that the 2 washers that were guiding that, made of that ceramic,
basically flaked into dust when vibrated at the spectrum expected for our launch. Now, it may not have been the Maycor. It turns out that they were not quite machined to the right tolerance. They were 50 microns too small or too large in the inner diameter. 50 microns. That meant that they didn't quite make contact with the cold finger, and so the cold finger was free to vibrate and flake them away. But to be safe, we're replacing these now with the Teflon, and we're replacing the other Maycor parts with titanium. And so we've disassembled the camera, cleaning the interior, make sure that there's no dust contamination under clean room conditions.
And so it's meant a delay of maybe 2 or 3 weeks in the project.
It's annoying, but it's not fatal. We certainly know what happened, and we know how to repair it. So it wasn't the best news, but we'll be back on track with another vibration test likely by the end of this month. Now, in terms of our science planning, we're in good shape. The only thing in terms of data archiving, we're working with the Canadian Astronomy Data Center in Victoria so that
eventually the data can be made available to the entire world community. But we have simulations. I've already shown you some of the exoplanets. We've also studied the metal-poor subdwarf models and so on.
We've also selected our targets. The MOST science team met at Harvard last December to pick our targets for year 1 and year 2,
and you can actually go to the David Dunlop Observatory doings online or to the MOST website and read a little article by Slavik Ruchinsky depicting that. Here's the science team group photo taken at that meeting, and oh, by the way, if you want to learn any secrets of MOST, we inadvertently didn't erase the blackboard in the background, so there's some stuff up there that we weren't intending people to know ahead of time, but that's all right.
Tony Moffat, some of you know from the University of Montreal, Werner Weiss, Vienna, David Gunther, St. Mary's, Gordon Walker at UBC, Dimitar Sasilov, a Bulgarian at Harvard, but who studied at U of T, and so he's sort of he's our token American, but he's actually a Bulgarian who studied in Canada, Reiner Kuznick, my instrument scientist from Austria,
and Slava Kuczynski, the director of the David Dunlop Observatory, and in some sense the godfather of MOST, because he was the first person who really recognized the potential of taking Dynacon's technology and applying it for an astronomical satellite, and some guy. And you could be there. And what I wanted to emphasize is that although we've been preoccupied with getting MOST running and off the ground, one of our goals from the very beginning was to incorporate the Canadian amateur community, the public, through the RESC into the MOST project, that after year one, year two, and you can go to the website and find our year one and year two targets, by the way, we would like to open it up through maybe an amateur observers competition run by the RESC in conjunction with the MOST science team to give people an opportunity to make proposals to use MOST for other types of photometry, because the Canadian community here are experts on variable star observations with small telescopes. And the secondary science field is basically a treasure trove of potential variable stars, eclipsing binaries, all sorts of variations here. Here's some simulations. You get beautiful, beautiful data. The amplitudes here are amazingly small. And so you could basically either, so, you know, think about a primary target for our Fabre photometry, or a secondary target near a primary field. And we will have, it's not quite on the website yet, but we will have a target identification interface that's developed at the University of Vienna that will help you figure out that if MOST is looking at a particular object, what's near it in the field that you could possibly propose to observe. So that's something that's going to be developed in advance of the MOST launch, which right now is scheduled for the 17th of December, 2002. The Russians are going to launch us aboard what the Americans used to call the SS-19 Stiletto, basically a former Soviet ICBM, intercontinental ballistic missile. One of the things that used to be pointed at us has to be destroyed as part of arms limitation treaties. Instead of dismantling them, they're using them to launch commercially small payloads into space. And so we've signed a contract with them. Got a pretty good deal. Again, it helps. Mission scientists drink a lot of vodka. we'll be launched from a place called Plesetsk, 800 kilometers north of Moscow, in December, former Soviet military launch site. So think about it, just south of the Arctic Circle, former military concrete bunker site in December. So it's basically Club Med, totally inverted. But it'll be exciting to be there for the launch. And just to finally summarize the status, here is the official spacecraft project normal bitterness curve. This is where we started when we first got our funding, the region of euphoria. We've been working our way through. We are now right about there, which is why I'm kind of relieved to be in Montreal, because then nobody's biting my head off back at UBC. But actually, we're still a pretty friendly team. Things have gone remarkably smoothly and on budget, given the challenges of this project.
And just to give a Quebec flavor, here is one of our summer students who was working at Spectral from Laval, who was helping us out. And she's got a big smile on her face. And we don't always have smiles on our faces, but we expect to be smiling within a matter of months, and certainly next year. I hope at a future GA I'm going to be able to share with you the first scientific results from MOST. So thank you very much for being a very tolerant and patient audience. Questions, except during the 30-second coffee break that's allowed by the schedule.